Hello, everybody. This is Peter Cooper from the NCBI Service Desk, and welcome to another NCBI webinar. This is one of our shorter ones, the ones we call the NCBI Minutes, so we'll be talking for about 10 minutes here. Just some reminders, and that's what this slide is for, that the recording of this webinar will be available on our YouTube channel. Probably take us about a week to 10 days to get that up there. The materials, which basically are some backup slides that show you the kind of screenshots we're going to be showing you today, are available on our FTP site, and that compressed URL there will take you to those materials. So today, Melissa Landrum, who is the lead developer for the ClinVar resource, is going to be talking about the new ClinVar Submission Wizard, and I'm going to turn it over to Melissa right now.
Thanks, Peter. Hello, everyone. Thanks for joining us today. ClinVar is the NCBI database for archiving interpretations of variants relative to diseases and other phenotypes. All interpretations in ClinVar are provided by our submitters, namely clinical testing labs, research labs, resources like OMIM, gene reviews, and locus-specific databases, as well as expert panels and practice guidelines. A link to information on how to submit to ClinVar is available from the ClinVar homepage. Submitters who have several interpretations to submit, or submitters that submit repeatedly, like clinical testing labs, use our submission spreadsheet templates, and there's a section here on this page with information about those templates. For researchers and other submitters who submit a single variant at a time, it may be easier to use the ClinVar Submission Wizard to guide you through the submission process. For example, a genetic counselor may review a variant in a lab report and want to submit her own interpretation to ClinVar, or a research lab may be publishing a paper on a new causative variant for a disease. To get to the wizard from this page, you can click on How to Submit, and you'll see a link here to NCBI's Variation Submission Portal. So we'll click on that. Also note that you can get to the submission portal from NCBI's homepage. For this demo today, I'm going to switch to an internal site, but note that when you use the submission portal, you will not need to make any changes to the URL. When you first log in to the Variation Submission Portal, you'll need to register your organization. You can use this help link at the top of the page if you need more information to do that. Once your organization is registered and approved, on this page, you'll see the name of your organization. So here for my demo, my organization name is ClinVar Submission Test Lab. And that will be followed by two buttons. One is for the ClinVar Single Submission Wizard, and the second is to upload a new file submission like a spreadsheet. So today we're going to click on the button for the submission wizard. The wizard walks you through a series of tabs for different kinds of information. The first tab is for general information about your submission. Here you'll provide a name for the submission, which is just for your own use in submission portal. You can use the name that's provided or you can give your own name. So today I'm going to submit a variant that causes CFC syndrome, so I'm going to name my submission CFC1 variant 1. If your submission is part of a named study like the CSER project or the Framingham study, you can provide the name and a description of that study in these boxes. If your submission is from a standalone research project, you can just leave these boxes blank. You can let us know if you need your submission held until the corresponding paper is published by selecting Hold Until Published here. For this example, I'm going to select Public so that my submission is not held. If the citation is already available, you can provide that information in this section. So today for my demo, I'm going to provide a publication using a PubMed ID. Note that on each tab, your work is not saved until you click the Save and Continue button, but that does mean that you can start a submission, save your work for one or more tabs, and come back to the form later to complete the process. So I'll click Save and Continue, and that takes us to the next tab where you can indicate which organizations should get attribution for the submission. If your submission is from a single organization, like a single research lab, you can select Single Organization here and save immediately. The organization for which you have logged on will be used automatically. If your submission is from multiple groups, Each of those groups needs to be registered and approved in the submission portal first, and you will need to have been defined as a submitter for each organization. Then, when you select multiple organizations, all of those groups are available in this table. One should be specified as the primary organization for the ClinVar submission, and any number of others can be specified as additional organizations. For today's example, I'm going to submit from a single organization. Use the next tab to define the variant that you've interpreted. The interpreted variant may be a single variant, like a single nucleotide substitution, two single variants as a compound heterozygote, or multiple variants in cis as a haplotype. To describe the location of the variant and the change that you observed, you can use either HGVS nomenclature or chromosome coordinates, here called sequence location. When you select the type of variant and method of description, the page updates to provide the appropriate fields for you to fill in. For this example, I'm submitting a single variant in the BRAF gene. So I'm going to describe with an HGVS expression. So I will fill in the reference sequence with accession and version, a description of the sequence change. So that would be, say, the C dot or G dot portion of an HGVS expression. I'm going to fill in the gene. Note that you can start typing the gene symbol and you'll get a list from which to choose. I'm also going to provide an alternate designation here. This is the protein name, but this could be any other name by which that variant is known, including other nucleotide descriptions with legacy numbering systems. There are other optional fields to fill in. You could provide a variation identifier like a DBSNP RS number. You can tell us the location of the variant, so the intron or exon that it's in, your local identifier for the variant if you have a database, or the functional consequence. Note that most of these fields on this tab are optional, so you can just fill in the information that you have. Variants in ClinVar are generally interpreted with respect to a disease or condition, so this condition is indicated on the Conditions tab. If you have information to submit on observed phenotypes or clinical features, please wait to submit them on the Observations tab. The condition for which you are interpreting the variant can be described with a database identifier, like an OMIM number, or you can provide the name of the disease in this box. In some cases, a variant is submitted to describe its effect on a person's response to a drug. So for these cases, you can select Drug Response here, and the page updates to let you enter the drug name and, optionally, the condition for which that drug is used. For this example, I'm going to submit on a disease, CFC1 syndrome, and I'm going to do so with an OMIM number. Use this tab to describe your interpretation of the clinical significance of the variant. You must provide a value for the clinical significance, and the options for that are available in this pull-down menu. So I'm going to submit that this variant is likely pathogenic. And then, optionally, you can also provide other information, such as the mode of inheritance for that variant. Again, options are provided in a menu. You can provide the date that the clinical significance of that variant was last evaluated. And you can also provide a comment that describes why you classified the variant as you did. This tab also lets you provide information about the method that you use to classify variants, which in ClinVar we call your assertion criteria. More information about this is available on the ClinVar website using this link. But in short, this is a document that describes the categories that you use to classify variants, such as benign, uncertain, and pathogenic, and the criteria that you require to assign a variant to each category. If this information is in your publication describing the variant, the PubMed ID can be provided as the assertion criteria here. We do encourage submission of assertion criteria if it is available, because it affects the review status or number of stars on the resulting ClinVar record. But it is not required, so you can certainly submit your data to ClinVar without assertion criteria, leaving this section blank. ClinVar submissions also include the evidence that supports the interpretation in the form of observations of the variant. Those observations may be described as aggregates, individuals, or experimental results. At least one observation is required per submission. If you want to submit data from many individuals as a group, you can use the aggregate section. You can submit information about more than one group as distinct aggregates. For example, if you had information from a case control study, you could complete a section for the cases and another for the controls. In other words, all of the information in this observation applies to everyone in this group. If you prefer, you can provide information about each individual with the variant. So in this case, all of the information is specific to that person, such as that person's age, their ethnicity, or the phenotypes that were observed in that individual. For research groups who have performed functional assays to evaluate a variant, that experimental evidence can also be described. That information might include the cell line used in the experiment or the tissue type that was analyzed. And you can also provide a comment that describes the result of your experiment. More structured details about the experimental methods can also be provided. For this example, I'm going to submit one aggregate observation. So this is information about a group of affected individuals with this disease. So I'm going to name my observation. I'm going to indicate, yes, that they were affected with the disease. I'm going to indicate that the allele origin was germline. This variant was detected as a germline variant. And I'm going to indicate that this data was collected with clinical testing. I'm also going to indicate that this was seen in a mixed group of males and females. The age range for these individuals is from 1 to 20 years. And I'm going to indicate that I saw this variant in 6 families and a total of 6 single heterozygotes. When you've entered your information, make sure to click Save and Continue. And when you've entered all of your observations, click Save and Continue, which takes you to the final tab. This is an overview of the information that you've provided. You can take this opportunity to review the data and go back and correct anything if necessary. Once you're finished, click the Submit button at the bottom of the page. This is a critical step. This sends your data to ClinVar and sends you an email confirming that you've submitted your data. When we receive the submission, one of the ClinVar curators will check it and contact you if there are any questions about the data. Otherwise, your data will be promptly processed and made available on the ClinVar website. We encourage you to try the ClinVar Submission Wizard, and we welcome your feedback. You can use the contact link at the top of this page to send us any questions or suggestions about the wizard. So if we have time for a few questions, if anyone wants to send those in, we'd be happy to answer them. So the first question that we have is, how do I know if I should use the wizard or use a spreadsheet to submit to ClinVar? So our recommendation is if you're submitting a very small number of variants at a time, let's say less than 5, it will probably be useful to use the wizard. If you're submitting more variants, let's say more than 5 or 10 variants, you will probably get faster processing of your submission if you use the spreadsheet, because that makes it a more efficient process for our curator to review many variants at a time and get back to you with any issues so that it can be processed more quickly. The second question we have here is, if I find that I've made a mistake in my submission, can I get in to edit it? So if you have already sent your submission into ClinVar, so here in the table you can track the progress of your submission. So this is the one I just entered, and you can see the status is submitted and it does not have an edit button here. So once you've already sent it to ClinVar, it is not available to edit. If one of our curators finds something that needs to be fixed, we will change the status so that there is an edit button here available for you to fix your data. If you have not yet submitted your wizard submission, you will see an edit button here, and you can go in and make any edits until you're ready to submit. So we have another question. Should people only use the wizard for submissions where they have made their own assertion on the variant, or would clinicians use this to report assertions directly from lab reports? So you can certainly use it to submit your own assertion of the variant. So whether or not clinicians can use it to report directly from lab reports, You can certainly. Actually, for that, I would actually suggest at this point that if you would like to do that, you can use the spreadsheet. And the reason is that the lab themselves may have already submitted that interpretation to ClinVar. And if you are going to submit somebody else's assertion, we need to know who the testing laboratory was. So that is a feature that we will add to the wizard in a future release. But for now, that information can be submitted on the spreadsheet. So if you would like to submit that kind of information and you need help with the spreadsheet, please do feel free to contact us.
Okay, this is Peter Cooper. I'm back again. Thanks, Melissa. That was great. And that's all we have time for today. So we'll have the slides and materials that sort of show you those screenshots available on our webinars and courses page. And we'll have this recording up on our YouTube channel probably within a week or 10 days. Thanks, everybody, for coming. I'm going to go ahead and end the webinar.